Hi guys, and welcome back to 2018, and most importantly, to my channel. And today, I want to be covering a game that I haven't really put much content up on about, and that is because it is something that's on me, and for that, I want to apologize. So, this video is going to be my way of reaching out politely to the guys over at Retto, or Retomoto, as they want to be called, the guys that make this game, Heroes and Generals. Now, I did ask in my Discord, if I can get a hold of my Discord, that'd be nice, thank you, Discord. I did throw out a question in my Discord, and as you can see, my chat is still going nuts over this question, so I'm going to let you guys know what the question was, which was, here's a question I want to ask you all about H&G and what to do slash think could be done within the game engine slash system mechanics wise to help improve the quality of life, or QOL, and art and quality of life. I ask because I want to address this in a video for YouTube. This is the video. Funky, Lone Wolf, Pope, Rick D, these are all loyal followers of mine, and guys, I love you and I thank you so much, same as Fighter Pilot and a few others. They all had valid points, and so what I'm going to do in this video is I'm going to give my two cents on this addressment and ways that now bear in mind, disclaimer, I don't work for Retomoto. They don't know of this video, they don't, you know, in all honesty, I don't even think they care. None of them are followers of my channel. None of them are subscribed to me on Twitch or follow me on Twitch. None of them. Yeah, I know secretly some of them have watched my channel in the past. So, anyway, fix the prices. They're so damn expensive. I have to agree. Let's take a look at one of my unranked soldiers. Now, I recently did purchase a little pocket pistol. Now, bear in mind, there is a sale on right now. A 50% sale. This is why I'm going to be live streaming Heroes and Generals today in attempts to unlock my Falschgummjägergewehr, Falschgummjägergewehr 42, if you want to pronounce it properly. Its normal market price is 217,000 credits, or 2,600 gold, which is their premium currency. For basically what it is, a portable machine gun assault rifle. By today's standards, it would be considered a full battle rifle infantry support weapon, like very similar to the Enfield L86 A3 or A2. But that's a lot of bloody money for a light machine gun that you're not even going to see any return on investment on within the first 20 to 50 missions. I call each map a mission because they are. You're just not gonna see any kind of return on investment. You're not. So there's that. I mean, look, it's 150 something thousand for a machine pistol 40, for an MP40. 158,000. Okay, let's see how much it is for a brand new soldier, shall we? Click the little plus button. Recruitment, 35,000. It was 71,000 for a paratrooper, just under 10,000 for an infantryman, 208,000 for a marksman. Yes, you do get a scoped Kar 98. Ooh. 120,000 for a tanker. Which, I'm sorry, tankers, if they're done right, kitted right, squatted right, on the right map, will do more damage repeatedly, endlessly, than snipers or paratroopers combined. 200,000 for a pilot. And what is it, like a 2 million for a general? I can understand the generals being that price. I can. Because that's end game content. Or is it? This is another thing I want to address later on in this video. So, to address Funky's question, fix the prices, they're so damn expensive. Yes, yes they are. I wholeheartedly agree that yes, the prices are out of control. And they're out of control for quote-unquote balance reasons. Um, because they don't want everyone to run around in Panther tanks or Tiger tanks or whatever. That to me isn't a weapon problem. That to me is a matchmaker problem. Plain and simple. You're just passing the buck down the line at that point. Lone Wolf stuck. How about actually listening to the community when they ask you to fix something and not just add more camo for content? The camos have been a long time coming. I don't see the point of adding camoed helmets and camoed masks and whatnot. Don't get me wrong, I think it's about time that they did add some fluff content, and that's what camos are. Camos are usually something that the big development teams like EA and Infinity Ward and Bungie and all these other big developers put into their game about 6 to 8 months in after the initial development is done, and they can't go anywhere. The art department can't go anywhere, or the content department is what the content department is what some game companies call them now, and they can't go on anymore. Redomoto is a very small company, and so they would rather give us breadcrumbs of cheese instead of the whole wheel of cheese. If that makes sense, that they're trying to appease the fan base by giving us crumbs instead of a whole wedge of cake or cheese. Why am I doing a food parody? Anyway, point is, that is what they're trying to do. They are trying to appease the player base, basically. Pope, my quarrel with HNG isn't necessarily the game mechanics. It's more or less the company pumping out airplanes, new skins, and instead of actual content and updates to be excited for. Again, that goes in line with the whole skins thing, Pope. I would have to say, without a shadow of a doubt, you are both right, but at the same time, you're both wrong. Let me explain. Now, I don't work for Redo, okay? Full disclaimer, I don't work for Redo. I haven't been invited to any of their conferences and whatnot. And even if they did, I couldn't go. Why? Because my passport is out of date. So I can't even travel until I get my new passport. But the point is, again, it's just fan base appeasement. That's what they're doing, is they're appeasing their fan bases. You've got new players who are saying, hey, I'm new to the game, you know, I would like something to unlock. Again, passing the buck down the line. And so they go, oh, here's some camos. And sadly, the camos are only for the infantry. As you can see, there's, you know, a whole bunch of camos right here. Some of the camos, again, everyone assumes that the Germans are the better because they get full camo and stuff. No, it's not it at all. That's not it at all. If you're worried that an enemy soldier is going to be looking at your groin, there's something wrong with you, bro. There's something seriously wrong with you, man. Has nothing to do with soldiers wanting to look at your groin. Trust me, has nothing to do with a soldier wanting to look at your groin. Camo aside, I think, again, it's just breadcrumbs. It's all it is, just breadcrumbs. Rick D, Armor 2.0 seems promising. Everyone gets mad about camo, but I watched enough dev streams to know that it fits in. The problem with Reto, that is a small team of specialized people. Reto A1 does vehicles, B1 does camo, C1 does maps. But he needs D1 in 2 to make props. But Redo D1 and 2 are busy making something else. And basically, it's basically if one department is dragging their heels, everyone drags their heels. And again, that's understandable. They are a game development. I know I'm in the process of developing my own game, as you guys know this. I explained this middle of the year last year, and I mean, I'm only a team of like 2 or 3 of us, and we're slowly working on it. So yeah, like I said, look forward to it. It's gonna be an interesting alternate history World War II shooter kind of thing. Think Wolfenstein but multiplayer. There you go, the newer Wolfenstein but multiplayer, basically, just to summarize it all up. Ricky, one thing I would like to see, the depot system. Red Bjorn has confirmed that it would be a great thing in his mind, where there was everything over your faction, not over factions. and then reducing some of the prices on certain vehicles. Again, we've already talked about the prices. Like the Weasel and the Amphibious vehicles that don't ever get used. The Weasel is just a huge freaking target. It's too loud, it's too open, it's too tall, if you will, like a Sherman. Sherman tank is just too tall. That was its problem. The Sherman tank was designed to, height-wise, was designed to fight in Africa, and terrain that has a lot of hills, where it can use its gun depression over the Germans. Because Germans are low and wide. Americans are skinny, skinny and tall. Yeah. Amphibious vehicles, maybe the cut and crud as well. Don't own one, so I won't say so as much, because these vehicles are very cool and stuff, but not extremely practical in all terms. No, exactly, they're not practical at all. And you know, morale decision, we repair, but yeah. Different combat badge system. I wholeheartedly agree. As a veteran player, this is my third account. I've got, you know, previous accounts have been banned for stupid reasons. One of which was I loaned an account to a friend who used a hack. I can even prove to you that I am, you know, I don't use hacks. I can go simply to my Steam settings. There you go. No VAC bans, ever. I have never received a VAC ban whatsoever because I don't hack. Never have, never will. But anyway, that aside, the badges, yes, I agree that the badges do need overhauling completely. I feel that the badge mechanic system does need a lot of rework, does need a lot of love. There are so many badges in the game that do nothing, that are completely pointless. And if they do anything, it doesn't say. Or it's so situational that they're really not worth it. Even if you go out of your way to make that situational scenario your key thing for your character, for whatever. For example, where is it? It's a bloody cone of fire one that that's lower as you turn. There you go. Quick draw. By practicing holding your weapon exactly the same way when you move, you can limit sway and turning around fast. You see, it's too situational. Dynamite lover, why? Unless you want to hemorrhage credits because grenades cost too much. AP mines are just not cost effective. Anti-tank mines, yeah, if you want to go the whole, you know, clink, clink, you know, take three extra H3s, taking on heavy tanks or medium tanks where you're going to reap your rewards, but not on light tanks because, why, there's Panzerfausts everywhere. It's just really not worth it. Again, it's a very... Dynamite lover, what's the other one? Dynamite lover, car thief. I don't see the point of car thief. By the time you've got car thief gold, you've got all the damn vehicles unlocked for your faction. Why would you want to still? I mean, yes, unless you're a completionist and want to get 4-star gold in the US Jeep and the Soviet Gaz, or you know, it's just pointless. I do not see the point of car thief. It's such a situational badge. It doesn't need to be in the game. Same as aircraft thief. What fucking pilot, pardon my French, is going to land his bloody plane and allow you to steal it? And even then, you can't resupply the bombs. You can't resupply the ammunition. So once you fired all the bullets and dropped all the bombs, the plane is freaking useless. Therefore, ergo, the badge is friggin' useless. Same as tank thief. It's too situational. Wow, yeah, you sniped out the tank driver. You go up to the vehicle, you start hot wiring it. If the tank was already running when you sniped the driver, Why do you have to hotwire the tank? Did this, like I said, the badge system needs some overhaul, some love. It also stems into another counterpoint I can make for the badges, which is, and it also stems to the player base, which is add in masteries, combat masteries, weapons masteries, vehicle masteries. Let me explain. I'm pretty sure, as you guys know, Cotton Gamer, one of the biggest fans and players of Heroes and Generals, quit playing Heroes and Generals and started playing a game called Escape from Tarkov. I play Escape from Tarkov. I don't stream it that much, but when I do, it's just to have fun. But point is, he quit primarily because there was nothing left to do in Heroes and Generals. You are losing your veteran players, okay, because there is nothing for them, like myself, to do. Nothing. Nothing. You need to add mastery badges. For example, let's take a look there needs to be a thing where you can just look at your badges instead of micromanaging to find three little buttons. For example, I've maxed out my recon, but I've got boosters for it. Why? I'm not going to use it. I'm sorry, but I'm not going to use my so I'm getting trickle amounts of recon EXP that's going nowhere, that does nothing. So give us a mastery badge. Okay? So let me just click on the view progress. As you can see, I've maxed it out. I've got my freaking little recon camouflage gold badge. So if I really wanted to switch him to sniper and be a pain in the ass, I can. Not that I want to, but I could. So why not have the bat ribbons go up to rank 15 and past 12 is mastery, you know, mastery 5, mastery 4, mastery 3, mastery 2, mastery 1 or masterclass. Okay? And what that will do, okay, is unlock the enemy's weapons. A 1903, a moist nugget, or a Mosin Nagant. Do you see? It would give the veterans something to play for, something to grind for, because guess what? Hell, you could even throw in a US camouflage, Soviet camouflage, for your German recon, and vice versa. Russian recon, German recon for your American, or American camo, or and German camo for your Soviet. Do you see what I'm saying? Maybe even give us a special piece of equipment, like a ghillie suits and stuff like that. And please do not give me no crap about there weren't ghillie suits in World War II. Yes, there was. Because, oh look, two Canadian snipers wearing early ghillie suits. Japanese ghillie suit. German ghillie suit. Russian ghillie suits. They were in the game. You've already figured out how to add camos and whatnot. Add in a simple model change so that his uniform is camoed. That's it. That's it. That's all you've got to do. That's all you've got to do. Do you see? That's all you've got to do. See? See? I just helped you right there. I'm not looking to shit on you, Redo. I'm not. I'm looking to help you. So add mastery class badges past rank 12. 13, 14, 15. You know, hell, even add a new badge into the damn game. You know, where an enemy highlights you. You know, and they don't even get a red dot. To them, you're an ally. So they leave you alone. Do you see? Or a suppressor. Imagine that. Holy fucking crap. Mastery rank, you know, mastery rank one, a master sniper. You can attach a suppressor, which did exist. Again, here. Here you go. The Sten submachine gun had a suppressor. Here you go. Oh, look. A Luger with a suppressor. Well rod pistol. You could add that in. Treat it just like a one shot kill bolt action. You know? You can do it, guys. There you go. There's an M1 M2 carbine with a suppressor. A Walther P38, a Luger 08. Thompson submachine guns, Sten submachine guns. M3 grease gun with a suppressor. M1 carbines with suppressors. It's right there. You can do this. I know you can do this. Okay, I know you can do this. So let me just go back to my Discord real quick and get the next question up for you. Abnormal physics. When they have abnormal physics since day one, the truck's hitting a train track, it stops you dead from going at 40, 50 miles per hour. Or how does your vehicle randomly spin out and does a freaking 180. I've done videos on that. It was one of my top 10 things that Redo needs to fix. They did say that they are working on the physics, so I'm not going to touch that. Again, another question about the physics. A rework on the support gunner system would be good. The current system, you spawn in, you pray, you shoot, and you ain't getting shit. It's boring. My idea. You spawn in on someone, you can shoot, and you can peek out. You can get out tanks, you can get out and defend the tank with your gun, you can repair it, you can walk a tiny bit away to spot enemies. If you walk too far, you will despawn and you'll have the ability to spawn back inside the tank with a deploy queue on your own or to spawn in on your own tank. This links in with the planned deploy reworks. Planes basically the same except a tiny bit less useful. You can only get out when the plane has landed and can help repair again. If you are too far from the vehicle, you despawn. I have to disagree with the plane. Simply because certain players will realize, wait, Joe Blow 1234 has his friend Blow Joe 567 and he can't get out, so that's a guaranteed kill. Do you see? So I'm just going to keep farming this guy. Just keep farming. Keep farming. If he can't parachute out. Do you see what I'm saying? Or his friend's a useless pilot and they don't have AUG seats, so they can't swap. I don't agree with the plane part. The despawn part, unless you get like a warning up on your screen like you did in Battlefield, you know, return back to the battlefield, soldier, you know, kind of thing. If you're going out of bounds, I think that would be pretty cool. Other than that, there's really no way you could determine the range of how far you can leave the vehicle, you know. So there's that. How about having real flight models and I'm not a brick with an engine? Good point there, Lone. I have a fighter pilot in the American faction and the German faction. Here's my German fighter pilot to prove it, because a lot of people are like, just prove it. Okay, there's my German fighter pilot. I don't think I have a Soviet fighter pilot yet. Oh, that's right, I turned him back to infantry. Sorry, not Scarface. Is it Scarface? No. It was Todd. It was War Daddy that was my fighter pilot. And I can show you, because I should have some badges still. Aviation. Yeah. So I turned him in. No, he was a tanker. Sorry, tanker. Yeah. But anyway, I've got fighter pilots. Soviet. Yeah, it was my Soviet. Soviet. But yeah, there you go. So it's my Soviet. And so I have to agree. The flight models of the planes are ridiculous. So is the damage models. If I've unloaded 20 plus, 30 plus 20mm cannon rounds into your left wing, your right wing, your tail, your engine, you're going to go down. I'm sorry, the sheer volume of damage is going to take your plane down. Again, I'm going to use good old Google here, you know. And we're just going to take a look. I mean, look. Just look. Do you see? Look. You're going to go down. Okay? There's no ands, ifs, or buts about it. Your flight. Look. See? Your flight model is going to be knackered. You know? I mean, yeah, the typical Soviet. Oh, your boy. Yeah. Keep flying, comrade. You know? Point is, okay, your flight model is going to drastically change. You know, look at how War Thunder does it, okay? And I know you tweaked your flight models because of games like War Thunder, okay? You get shot in the left wing, what's your left wing doing? It's dipping. Do you see? Why? Because it's not got enough drag as if the right wing does. Do you see? So your plane is starting to lean now. Or you can't land, you can't get your landing gear out because your hydraulics are shot. Or you're on fire, or you're leaking fuel. See, right now in Heroes and Generals, there is no gas tanks. So you don't have to go back to base to rearm and refuel. For planes or tanks, for that matter. But you do as a soldier. So don't you think that's a bit unfair to the infantry, your backbone of your game? Everyone on foot has to resupply at a resupply point or heal at a healing station, but not a fighter pilot and not a tanker. If a tank runs out of ammo, all it has to do is just bugger off, wait 10 to 30 seconds depending on their badges and whatnot, and their ammo's back. Fighter pilot, he has to wait 60 seconds or 90 seconds. I think it's 90 seconds now. It used to be 60. Has to wait 90 seconds for his bombs to come back, his cannons to come back, and his machine guns to come back. He doesn't have to return to an airfield. He doesn't have to land. He doesn't have to risk shit. Yet infantry do. And you wonder why you have a P-38 spam issue or a tank spam issue. Here's a hint, you want to balance the entire game, force tanks and planes to land and rearm. Plain and simple. Force them to. That break in the sky, that break in the tank combat where the infantry can actually move up, will actually make games like on airfield not be a fucking stalemate for an hour and a half, 2 hours, especially in a three-way battle. Just saying. A little bit of balance there for you. As for the flat models, yeah, I'm sorry. But if I'm in a 20, if I'm in a German flat gun and I've unloaded 60, 80, 100, 120 plus 20 millimeter rounds, 20 millimeter rounds into your lightly armored plane, and you're still flying? You got issues. Big issues. Alright. What's next? Oh, the P-38 retardation. No, the P-38 is not overpowered. It's overpopulated. Period. It is. That's it. All the old school fighter pilots that bought pilots just before the change and got the P-38 for free instead of the P-40, instead of the crappy little biplane, that's why the P-38 is overpopulated. It's not overpowered, it's overpopulated. Same as the Germans. Why everyone assumes that the Germans are better. They're not. They're overpopulated. Why? Because of the retarded freaking weapons and sights that you forced on the Americans and the Soviets to use. Okay? The whole freaking anti-aircraft 30 cal freaking sight. No. Ditch it. Ditch it. If that's the case, then please put the anti-aircraft sights on the MG42, you know, that great big round fucking certain that looks like a freaking tea strainer, right on the freaking on the iron sights of the MG42, please. Oh, and same for the DP28, because, you know, all they used was water cooled DP28s with great big freaking, you know, go ahead, you want to nerf one LMG or light machine gun but not all the LMGs? That makes no fucking sense. Okay, makes no sense. Sorry, doesn't. Do it. If you do it to one, do it to all, or don't do it. Okay, show some fucking fairness and balance. You want to know why the Americans win? M3 grease gun. Why? Good fucking sights, mod it out for max rate of fire, you win, GG, that's it. Fast reload gold, heavy set gold, M3 grease gun, you've won. Okay. And by the way, the M3 grease gun came after the Thompson, not before. Just FYI. Let's see. Oh, and factory map. Yes, the factory map needs to be completely reworked. Give us multiple lines to choose. Okay, you pick the factory map. Let me just pick a soldier here real quick. Okay. Let's look at the factory map. Okay, this is the factory map. Notice that there's two lines. Okay, two lines. Give us four. Give us the ability to attack from the north, the south, the east, and the west. Give us four lines. And factory map will not be boring. Period. There won't be bloody Hellcats. Or SU-76s, or SU-85s, or T-34-85s, or Tigers, or Panthers, or fucking Panzer IVs, or Shermans, camping in the hills with HE spamming and just killing infantry because your spawn system's fucking stupid. What infantryman's gonna spawn out in the open? Oh, here I am, guys! Shoot me! I believe I can fly. Because you haven't fixed the spawn system. You will tweak and add stupid content like camos and freaking and whatnot, but you will not fix the core mechanics. If you cannot fix it this time around, just take the factory map out. Just take it out. Remove it. Take the factory map out. Take it out of the rotation. Put a thing up saying, sorry, factory map is out until we've fixed it. Plain and simple. How would you fix it? Like I just said, give us four lanes. Give us, and when we spawn in, give the squad leader, like you have done, the ability to pick which lane he wants to go, including the optional lanes. Okay? optional keyword. How do you make it an optional? Okay, plain and simple, because it's not an initial assault point, they only get half the resources, so half the infantry, half the jeeps, half the bikes, half the tanks, half the whatever, okay? Instead of the 100 and something infantry, once both spawns get, it only gets 60. Instead of the 50 recon that the other two spawns get, they only get 25. It gives the attackers an alternate attack route, plus it also gives the defenders something to actually fucking defend from. There you go. I just fixed factory map for you. Alright. What's next? Hard cap special units. Yes, I absolutely agree. When you've got 3 pilots, 7 paratroopers, 2 wanking recon, 3 flapping tankers, and only 3 infantry, how does that compose of a healthy team of 18? It doesn't. I honestly believe there should be a hard cap of a unit of 3 total. So 3 pilots, 3 paras, 3 recon, 3 tankers, and the rest infantry. There you go. Yes, if the infantry have a recon org seat, or a tanker org seat, or a para org seat, that's fine. That's fine by me. Why? Because that whittles down that specialty unit's lives even faster, which forces them back to playing infantry. A hard cap of 3 to 4 tops. Tops. No more, no less. Tops. And if they queue in as a paratrooper and you put them into a game where there's already 3 paratroopers, they can only spawn in as their infantry. Give everyone the ability to spawn in as an infantryman for free. No org seat required. There. That fixes that issue. What else? Wow, everyone in my chat is going off about the infantry thing. Remove HE from tanks and remove HE from planes. Remove high explosive from planes, yes. From tanks, no. Initially, because tanks were designed to be infantry support. And honestly, I believe that the HE... again, as an ex-tank driver, we were often told, you know, bring down that building. And we brought it down with high explosive, you know. Remove HE from tanks again. Yes, in the initial beginning, it will fix. Again, like I said, it will fix maps like factory where you got tanks camping just outside the spawn. The moment you bam, you know, it will stop people farming. But in the long run, it won't help. Maybe if they up the cost of HE shells for tanks to the point where it's like double the cost of an AP shell. So if the tanker wants to use a HE shell to get rid of infantry to win that capture point so they can move on, they can, but at a cost. You know what I mean? Again, most tanks mostly ran HE and very limited AP supplies. Again, I'm going to use Google here. Okay, typical ammo loadout for an M4 Sherman circa 1944. We'll play it nice. Okay, this is the M4 105, which was the howitzer Sherman. It's typical. There you go, doctrine. United States approached entry in World War II armed completely doctrine government field manual operations published on 1 which month followed section M4 tanks final design manual. Where is it? German success against the Germans. Blitzkrieg. There you go. Infantry support tank. Do you see? Which means they took primarily more HE than AP. I think they only had a max of like 20 to 22 AP rounds. Everything else they took was high explosive. And the tanks would usually park up on a hillside. you know, a good 1,200, 1,400 meters away, way out of a range of any Panzerfausts or PTRDs or any form of anti-tanks, petards, things like that, British petards, and just howitzer the bollocks, or mortar the bollocks, out of the soft targets. So there you go. Bring back the old squad system. No, again, there's a famous saying by an actor who said, "You never bathe in the same river twice." If you could host your own HNG server like in the Alpha, that would be good. In all honesty, hosting your old servers could lead to a lot of people with lag switches and various other things. The old Halo 2 tricks. It's like, oh, let me just turn off my internet for 5 seconds. Kill, 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 kill. Let me turn it back on again. Packets catch up. You know, you're going to get players that will do that. And they'll be like, oh, you're hacking. No, I've just got really shitty internet. Unless you want to purposely put in active ping kick filters, which means if their ping drops below 60 ms, 100 ms, they're instantly kicked, like you do in Battlefield and COD and various other games like that. So that's pretty much it. let's see. What would I like to see added into the game for its life, quality of life? Change the capture mechanics. Hear me out. Make it so that the closer you are to the radio, or in fact, better yet, interact with the radio by holding down your E key. Okay, so you're standing there. Little animation, you got the headset on, flip open a code book, you know. And your squad has to protect you. Okay? Your faction has to protect you in order to capture that zone. You still get the zone indicator saying, oh, three enemy are in the cap zone with you. But because they're nowhere near the radio, they can't capture it. They have to kill you and everyone else around you, then get on the radio and start decoding your code book. Do you see what I'm saying? And vice versa. You could do a King of the Hill star map. Take the original skirmish map. What is it? Take the original hillside? Yeah, take the original hillside. No, it had the rocks, the sniper rocks and whatnot. Take the original hillside, okay, and randomly rotate the capture zone, okay? Make the other two inactive, okay? But make the capture zone, okay, randomly appear, and they have to get to it. Recon have to move. They can't just stay in their little bush and snipe. They have to move. Paras have to move. Infantry have to move. Tankers have to move. Do you see? Add a King of the Hill skirmish style game. You've shown through dev commands that you can turn off capture zones and various other things. So write a batch script. See? Just write a batch script. Ta-da, done. Same within the game's mechanics. It's not that hard. First team to 100 points wins. You know? You could do that. What else could you do? When you capture a zone, okay, you know how in Call of Duty Zombies you can erect like planks of wood across windows and stuff for the zombies to pull down to get in? No, I'm not saying zombies. Relax, I am not saying zombies. What I'm saying to you is, how about once you've captured a zone, you can spend resources or your in-game credits, okay? You can spend your in-game credits to put up plywood slats across the windows that will allow you to look out and shoot and various other things. And then once the enemy capture that zone, okay, once the enemy capture that capture point, all the defenses are destroyed, and then they in turn can build defenses to try and hold it. The ability to buy anti-tank guns emplacements. For example, there is the, on the assault map, town. On the assault map, a town near 0201E, you know, E4, A4 area, you could, hell, even on C4 and B4, you could erect small, quick-firing 6-pounder guns. 74, 75, 76 millimeter anti-tank guns that the tanks can shoot at and take out. Do you see? Basically, the capture zones are bare. Okay, so the fighter pilots have to wait 5-10 minutes before they can come into the match. Same as paratroopers. They're on a cooldown. Okay? Or they can't come in until certain objectives have been captured. Ah, makes sense, see? So, the anti-aircraft gun on the bridge at Charlie 4, okay? It's not there, it's just a build platform, okay? I capture Charlie 1, and it asks me, what do I want to build, anti-aircraft or anti-tank? You select anti-tank. Those build platforms become active. Players can go out there with their wrench and start building. Bing! There it is. Player can get on it, can rotate it a certain degree arc, and start sniping away. Bam! Bam! Start shooting at tanks. It gives tanks something to be afraid of, other than just 80 Rambos. Now about that, demolitions. Or EOD specialists. Make them a specialist class. Don't get me wrong. Keep the Panzerfausts. Okay? Keep the H3s. Keep the British Stickies. Keep the Soviet Molotovs. Keep at least one handheld anti-tank weapon for the infantry. But have specialized anti-tank weaponry like the PTRD and various other things for EOD specialists. Actually make a new class called EOD specialists. There you go. Alright guys, this video has gone way too long, so I'm going to end it here. But stay safe, have fun, keep your shells flying, keep your enemies dying, Cobra Commanders out, and I'll see you sexy bitches on Twitch later on today. Bye.